So this question is very interesting to me because we have so many patients on active surveillance, and this patient has Gleason 6 prostate cancer, and they want to know if there's ever a time that they need to be thinking, yes, inevitably treatment is going to happen. I know that in a study with Dr. Lawrence Klotz, he did a study with, I think, about 2,000 patients and proving that Gleason 6 did not metastasize. So in that case, then, if the person has Gleason 6, if they had to experience treatment at some point, would that mean they had a completely different Gleason? Yes. A new tumor that popped up?
Yes, exactly. So men that are on active surveillance have prostate glands, and they can contract a new cancer. And there is possibly a chance that the Gleason 6 over time could change into a higher grade. So as long as it remains Gleason 6, it will not spread. But people need to be under surveillance for the possibility of a higher grade cancer appearing over time. This is not common, and men that are appropriately screened with MRIs and biopsies and whatnot, the chances of needing treatment in the next 10 years is probably about 10 to 15%. Men that don't have MRIs, it seems more likely it's 30 or 40% of men will need treatment within 10 years. But there are a lot of men. We've got men that have been watching their prostate cancers for 20 years and they have not needed treatment.
Just because somebody gets a Gleason 6, you know, tumor on their prostate does not automatically mean that they're going to get other tumor types, you know, Gleason 7, 8, or 9. It seems like you have patients who have just had Gleason 6 permanently and that's just it.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
That's incredible. If a patient is pre-diabetic, should he consider surgery instead of radiation to avoid adjuvant ADT, which may increase the risk of diabetes?
If a person is unconcerned about the development of impotence and incontinence, then I suppose there might be a small advantage to surgery over taking radiation plus hormones. The trouble is there are a few problems with that. And one is that the patients that require hormones with their radiation would probably also require hormones with their surgery. It's not a typical policy to give surgery with hormones, but many men with high-risk disease would be much better off if they did take hormones. As the idea is to eradicate the cancer at its inception rather than waiting for it to come back. I would not shy away from doing radiation plus hormones. I would not pick surgery because I think the other negatives of surgery are far more serious. And God forbid there is a little more problem with blood sugar, that could be managed with medications.
So the next question is letrozole effective for preventing further gynecomastia if it's already begun to occur?
I think the short answer is yes. Letrozole blocks estrogen. Some men, when they're taking hormone blockade, the residual testosterone gets converted into estrogen. They start to develop breast enlargement. Men who are on hormone blockade want to prevent the development of breast enlargement because the enlarged breasts don't go away after treatment is stopped. If someone wants to try and fix the situation, they're going to have to go through some sort of plastic surgery. So if the process has begun, it can be stopped either with radiation or with an estrogen blocker like letrozole or Arimidex. And these medicines are very well tolerated. They have few, if any, side effects. And we use them liberally in our patients that say they have any nipple tenderness or they think there's any enlargement.
In previous interviews, I've seen you talk about that if a patient is experiencing gynecomastia on any of these hormone therapies to stop and to, you know, talk to their doctor about it before any other breast tissue grows. Does that mean that they would need to switch to a different type of hormone therapy or are they all going to do the same thing?
Well, I don't know. I don't think you can simply stop hormone therapy. Typically, people are in for a certain course and they're sort of obligated for cancer reasons to continue on. So implementing various measures quickly before the breasts get bigger is what I would recommend, starting medications such as letrozole or talking to a radiation therapist about radiating the breast area.
How effective is shockwave therapy for erectile dysfunction after somebody's had surgery or radiation?
It's hard for me to get to the bottom of that answer. I know that there are a lot of places that are offering this service now, and I can only think of one patient that went through this treatment and said he thought that it really helped his situation. So apparently it can help some people. I've had a number of other patients that have tried it without really any benefit. So I'm not recommending it now until I see some more positive benefits.
I see it come up a lot in Google comments or things that people send us all about shockwave therapy. And it's really hard for PCRI especially to answer that, just as you stated, because, you know, we haven't seen any positive results either way. And it just sounds like, you know, a lot of things get marketed on the internet, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's great for you and effective. Even more, we need to talk about the side effects of them. Hey everyone, it's me, Alex, and our mascot, Hunter. You can check out his Instagram, Sir Hunter the Dow, at the link below. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, and in fact, if this dog high fives me, high five, high five. Can you high five me? Thank you. You have to subscribe. Go subscribe to the YouTube channel. He even thinks it's awesome. Also, don't forget to visit our website, pcri.org.